When We Were Alone by David A. Robertson and Julie Flett. Today I helped my cucum in her flower garden. She always wears colorful clothes. It's like she dresses in rainbows. When she bent down to prune some of the flowers, I couldn't even see her because she blended in with them. She was like a chameleon. "Nukum, why do you wear so many colors?" I asked. Nukum said, "Well, no sisum." When I was your age, at home in my community, my friends and I wore many different colors. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they gave us different clothes to wear. All the children were dressed the same, and our clothes weren't colorful at all. We all mixed together like storm clouds. "Why did you have to dress like that?" I asked. "They didn't like that we wore such beautiful colors," Nukum said. "They wanted us to look like everybody else." But sometimes, in the fall, when we were alone and the leaves had turned to their warm autumn hues, we would roll around on the ground. We would pile the leaves all over our clothes they had given us, and we would be colorful again. And this made us happy. "Now," Nukum said, "I always wear the most beautiful colors." After I helped with the flowers, we went over to the back gate. There were vines covering the gate, and they reached all the way to the ground. When my cucum turned to fix the latch, I saw that her braid hung almost as low as the vines. It was like she had a tail. "Nukum, why do you wear your hair so long?" I asked. Nukum said, "Well, no sisum." When I was your age, at home in my community, my friends and I grew our hair long, just like our people have always done. It made us feel strong and proud. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they cut off all our hair. Our strands of hair mixed together on the ground like blades of dead grass. "Why did you have to wear your hair like that?" I asked. "They didn't like that we were proud," Nukum said. "They wanted us to be like everybody else." But sometimes in the spring, when we were alone and the grass had grown so long and thick in the field, we would pick the blades from the ground. We would braid them into the short hair they had given us, and we would have long hair again. And this made us happy. "Now," Nukum said, "I always wear my hair very long." After my cucum had fixed the latch, I followed her to the birdhouse. There was a bird flying through the air like a jingle dress dancer. She fed the bird and whispered, "Na piesis, michiso, tamisikitian, tamiskayasian." And her words sounded just like a poem. "Nukum, why do you speak in Cree?" I asked. Nukum said, "Well, no sisum." When I was your age, at home in my community, my friends and I always spoke our language. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they wouldn't let us speak our words. All the children used their strange words, and we didn't understand them at all. Our voices blended together like a flock of crows. "Why did you have to talk in their language?" I asked. "They didn't like that we spoke our language," Nukum said, "but they wanted us to talk like everybody else." But sometimes in the summer, when we were alone and our teachers weren't anywhere around the place we would whisper to each other in Cree. We would say all the words we weren't allowed to say so that we wouldn't forget them. And this made us happy. "Now," Nukum says, "I always speak my language." After our gardening work was done, I sat with my cucum in the backyard. Her brother came over and sat with us. He comes over all the time. We drank tea and ate banak. The tea was hot and sweet, and the banak was moist and warm and melted in my mouth. My cucum and my uncle talked and laughed like children. "Nukum, why do you and Nokomis always spend time together?" I asked. Nukum said, "Well, no sisum." When we were your age, at home in our community, being with family was the most important thing. We played with each other, did chores together, and shared everything. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they wouldn't let us be together. My brother and I were separated like day and night. "Why were you and Nukum separated?" I asked. "They didn't like when we were with family," Nukum said. "Because when we were together, we thought too much of home." But sometimes in the winter, when we were alone, and we were sure that nobody could see us, we would find each other. We would take off our mitts, and in the crisp, cold air, we would hold hands so we could be with each other. And this made us happy. Now, Nookum said as she reached over and held my uncle's hand and mine, I am always with my family. Between the late 1800s and the 1960s, there were residential schools in Canada. The purpose of these schools were to take Native children away from their homes and their cultures and put them in schools that would make them more like the white Canadians that controlled the country. Canada viewed the Indigenous people as uncivilized and savages, and they wanted to stop that. Children in these schools were stripped of their traditional clothes, had their hair cut, and were not allowed to speak their native languages. These children did not have a choice in going to these schools and would often be taken from their homes with little to no warning. Once at the residential schools, Native children were abused, beaten, and punished, especially if they were caught speaking their native language. In Native cultures, their long hair is a spiritual and important symbol of their connection to the earth. At schools, their traditions and cultures were beaten out of them, and they were forced to learn how to look, talk, and act like the white majority in Canada. This way of making them act like the rest of the white people in Canada was called forced assimilation. Girls were taught to do laundry, sew, cook, and clean, and boys were taught woodworking and farming. Even though these were schools, a lot of the kids only attended part-time and had to work for the school, cleaning and farming, during other times. Because children were often kept in these schools their entire childhood away from their parents, it was incredibly difficult for many of them when it came time to have their own children. They didn't know how to be a parent because they didn't have parents growing up. They were in these schools. It is estimated that over 4,000 children died at these Canadian schools while they were open, but it is thought that there are actually many more. In 2021, the remains of 215 children were found buried on the grounds of the Kamloops Residential School in Canada.
Last year, archaeologists detected what they said could be 200 unmarked graves at this former school in Kamloops, British Columbia. Weeks later, a further 751 unmarked graves were detected across from the former Marivelle Residential School on the Cowessess Reserve in Saskatchewan. There was once a Catholic cemetery here, but the headstones were bulldozed in the 1960s by a priest after a dispute with a former chief.
And what were these lists for?
So it will tell.
A small team of researchers has been trying to discover the names of those children buried here, but for decades the government and the church have been reluctant to share their records. Chief Cadmus Delorme is trying to get answers.
Do you know that they're all children?
We can't verify how much are children, but based on the research we're doing, a lot of them were children that were forced to go to the Marivelle Residential School and died in the Marivelle Residential School.
Chief Delorme says he hopes to give the unidentified children a dignity in death that they never received in life.
These schools were meant to take Indigenous cultures away from their people and break their spirits. They were cruel and never should have existed. Now that we've talked about the history behind When We Were Alone, let's talk about it. Pause the video now to see discussion questions and talk to the people next to you.